Hotly, please stay with us. A very good morning to all. Welcome to today's webinar, Professional Etiquettes, Part 6 of the Personal Grooming and Image Building Series. Thank you all for joining us today. Mission Skills is an initiative by the prestigious B.K. Birla Autonomous College and Nest Academy for encouraging the aspiring young minds to develop and enhance their next-gen skills. This initiative is for the youth from colleges across the country. And I'm glad that we have received an overwhelming response for this series. We are grateful to our respected director, Dr. Naresh Chandra sir, Principal Dr. Aminash Patil sir, and Dr. Harish Dubey sir for providing us the opportunity to conduct these sessions. I would welcome Dr. Harish Dubey sir to share a few words.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. On behalf of B.K. Birla College, our management, director, principal, teachers, administrative staff, students, and everyone, I extend a warm welcome to Mr. Abhijit Patil for accepting our invitation and deliver his talk on professional etiquettes. I would also like to thank and appreciate the effort of Nest Academy for conducting such a wonderful session in the benefit of the students all over the country. I think learning professional etiquette is a need of the time. We are into different professionals, but we do not follow many times the etiquettes which are expected at the workplace. So today's session will tell us about the various kind of etiquettes which are expected at the professional places and which will be required and which will be beneficial in the future too. So once again, I extend a warm welcome to Mr. Abhijit Patil for accepting our invitation, and we shall listen to Mr. Patil as long as possible. And lastly, we shall conclude once again. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. So all the participants, before we get into the session, let me just explain to you, you can talk to us during the webinar using the Q&A box that is on the bottom of your screens. If you have any questions during the session, you can please put in your queries in the Q&A box. At the end of the session, we'll be opening up a Q&A round where we'll be taking up these questions. So yes, like Harisa mentioned that, you know, having these professional etiquettes is definitely the need of the hour. And for, I'm sure a lot of the viewers are students who have probably done some internships or will be getting into internships and placements, you know, they'll be starting off their jobs. So making that successful transition from campus to corporate is the most exciting journey, isn't it? And that definitely should be handled with utmost care. Professional behavior will definitely help us build strong relationships with the management, the staff, the peers, and you know, all those small things as handshakes and exchanging business cards and a lot of other things, you know, we need to take care of for building up those professional etiquettes. So for that, I'm very happy that we have Mr. Abhijit Patil here today with us for this session to share his experience and insights on these topics. We would like to welcome Mr. Abhijit Patil, who is an experienced human resource professional with an MBA in business management from the University of Newcastle. He has worked across diverse industries and specializes in talent management, HR consulting, employer branding, HR budgets, learning and development, performance management, and employee engagement. So, Abhijeet sir, please welcome. The session is over to you.
Thank you so much for the warm welcome, Sneha ma'am, and thank you so much, Harish sir, as well for welcoming, and thank you so much for all, also the fact that you have also given me a platform as well where I'm getting a chance to even present something that I have done with your students as well. So, yeah, if you're good to go now or how is it?
Yeah, sure. So we can begin. Yes.
Okay, great. So, yeah, like even sir mentioned, professional etiquette is something that is really very important. And I'll tell you certain tips and tricks on this. Because the time that you need to create an impact when you meet someone at the very first go, it's very less. So how certain tips and tricks, how certain etiquettes can like actually kind of help you in terms of your interviews or in terms of your meetings or even when you do presentations in the classes, how it can help you is something that I'll be sharing today. So next slide. So ideally, what I do is, you don't need to share that, just a sec. Yeah. So ideally, generally, now, if it's a classroom session or even when I do a session in NAMD, what I generally do is that I end up doing an icebreaker session with students, and I kind of ask them some really random, crazy questions where people, I give them some time to think, and then people start telling them something, telling us something about what they have done, what they like, what they dislike. And it turns out to be a really good icebreaker, because I've even observed that even students comes to know, kya isko ye achha lagta tha, isko wo achha lagta tha. But unfortunately, since it's not really a classroom session today, since we are really limited to a laptop and Zoom call, I thought I'll just take an onus on myself and I'll introduce myself in a different way, where not just I am talking about my work life, but also who am I as a person. So everything that I do, of course, has a purpose, which you'll definitely come to know later. If you click on next. So that is something that is my passion. I have been into cricket since probably third or fourth standard, and I've played for school, I've played for college, various clubs, companies. I literally, everything that I do is a copy paste of Rahul Dravid, who is like a big time idol for me. Whenever I am in any kind of stress or any kind of a problem, the one thing that I always feel is something to just go out, spend some time, do a jog, 40 minutes, 50 minutes, or even if it's an hour. But that is like an immense refresher for me. And if it's a weekend, generally you'll see most of the time I'm spending time with NGOs, looking after welfare of stray animals, or doing an immediate medical attention, or fostering, rescuing, a lot of things like that. Other than that, I'm also into counseling bit. I share experiences. Like I said, my sessions are more or less to do with sharing experience, because that is where I feel that the learning lies. You know, I get to know something about you as well. You get to know something about me as well. And yeah, other than whatever I do, I'm an HR by profession. I've been with different industries, namely consulting. I've been in a KPO. I have worked for production house in event industry. I have been in digital technology. So that is more or less about me as a person. Now, like I said initially as well, the reason I do is because I want people to think, okay, why I did this, or what really happened when I was talking about myself, which is the very next question that I would like to put forward. What did we all just do? So I would really like to have this session very engaging, and you know, any kind of participation would be really great. So I just wanted you guys to probably come up with some, you know, something. I mean, when I introduced myself, there must have been something that must have happened, you know, in your mind. Like I probably spoke about my passion for cricket, or I spoke about what I do for Stray Animals or something like that. Anything that you want to share on a chat or you want to talk? What were we doing when I was talking? Okay, I am either not able to see anything on the chat or not sure.
Anybody can answer in the chat box.
I mean, any idea, whatever you feel, you know, when I introduce myself, what just happened, there must be something that you guys might be doing, right? I mean, that is enough of a clue. Something must have come across your mind. Okay, so let me put this across. Okay, fine. Multitasker, listening to you carefully. Okay, fine. Something else, if you would want to just think a bit more, when I said something about myself, what did you do there? What happened? So these are the qualities that you're talking about. I'm saying you must have thought of something, right? You must have. Okay, let me just go to the next slide. Okay, analyze. I got a good answer finally. Yeah. Great. So yeah, someone said that you got to learn, you analyzed, which is kind of the thing that I was looking for. So do we all agree that when I introduced, we were kind of evaluating, we kind of judged, we formed some kind of opinions were going in our mind, right? We created a mental image, like when I spoke about something like, doing something for animals, you might have just pictured me with a stray dog or doing something like that. Or when I spoke about cricket, you might have just pictured about some net practices and things like that, right? So in a nutshell, what I'm trying to say here is that when we introduce ourselves in the very first minute or two, we are forming a first impression about that person, right? And that is what this discussion is going to be about. This session is going to be about, like, how do you really go about forming a first impression, and what are certain etiquettes that you really need to make a note of when you are having a very little time for forming that first impression. And the reason why I'm saying that you have a very little time for that is also something that I'll tell you in the coming slide. Next, please. Yeah. So like I said, it generally takes around 2 to 7 seconds. Now, I don't really want you to focus on the seconds and all, because that is not really the crux of the matter. The crux of the matter is whatever little time you have in front of the interviewer or when you do a meeting. So in my discussion, you will keep on hearing a lot of things, like, you know, maybe an example of an interview or in a meeting that you will go for a business meeting, you know, things like that. So whenever you go for a meeting or an interview, what we as individual or as a candidate would like to do, the very first thing is we want them to perceive us the way we want, right? Like, say for example, if I'm going for an interview for HR, I know that I would rather have 2 to 3 minutes where a person will ask me one very common question that all of us know. Tell me something about yourself, right? So if someone is asking me that, rather than me just talking about the entire history of my academics and which all companies I've worked with, what do I do, what do I don't do, my parents, my family background, I would rather want to create an impact by probably highlighting some of my core competencies in the very limited amount of time that I have. You know, so I want him to remember something very important about me, and that is what will be important. I want him to perceive the way I am to him. So even if it's an informal forum where you meet people across, you always want people to perceive you the way you want it to be, right? If you know that, yeah, you're a good guy, you've done something really good, you want them to know that as well. So that is what is important. And that is how it is going to help you in create a right first impression. And as we all say this, first impression is the last impression, right? Unless and until you're doing something really different, there's something completely magical that you've done later on where a person is able to change his impression about you, and then you are getting a second chance as well, right? So next slide. So now the question is, how do we really go about creating a right impression? of course, we can not communicate, because if we don't communicate, then forget about the question of even creating a right impression, right? So how do we really communicate? Now, basically, there are three mediums of communication. The very important is obviously the way you speak, your words, right? Your tone of voice, the way you speak, and your body language as well. So these are some of the three things that are important. Now, before I kind of proceed here, I just want to have a polling option. I spoke to Sneha ma'am about this, where I want you guys to tell me what is the most important thing according to you in communication, whether it is words, whether it is tone of voice, whether it is body language.
So yeah, y'all can also let us know your answers in the chat box. Yeah.
Okay, yeah, whichever way. Okay, great. So I believe some are saying all three are important, but I can see most of you guys are saying that body language is the critical part. Okay, some are saying tone of voice, but yeah, maximum I can see the vote is going to definitely body language, right? So any guesses, how much percentage of messages generally conveyed with words? You can chat and let me know. How much percent do you think your message is getting conveyed through words? So let me tell you, through words, only 7% of messages communicated. Only 7%. So imagine 93% of your communication is completely your tone of voice and your body language, right? Like how you speak, your dialect, your body posture, the way you talk, the way you present yourself is so important other than words. So if you look at your tone of voice, that basically comprises of 38%, okay? And 55% is for body language. And this is something that study shows, where body language is so critical, where you need, where your confidence level also comes into the picture. So next slide. Yeah, so certain serious facts, like really serious facts that I thought of sharing with you guys. 33% of bosses claim that they know whether or not they will hire a person within first 90 seconds. Now, if you just think about this sentence, 90 seconds is worth the time, and it's a staggering number, guys. When I'm saying that one third of your bosses are just saying that they can take a call whether to select or not in a span of 90 seconds, be it 90 seconds, 2 minutes, 3 minutes. I'm not really focusing too much on the time that we are spending, but imagine how little of a time you have to create a right impression, you know, to make people feel that you are the right person for this role. So this could include so many things. It could include the way you greeted that person in a span of 2 minutes, what all things you can do. You can, the way you greet a person, the way you do a handshake probably, the way you meet a person with a smile. A common question is probably asked where you have to talk about yourself. But remember this thing, it's a very important point to note, that you are not going to have like 15, 20 minutes to create your first impression. You have a very less time of just 2 to 3 minutes maximum. 2 to 3 minutes is also, I'm saying, because from an HR perspective, because end of the day, it is our efforts where we bring candidate and we want to explore that candidate to a maximum possible extent, so that where we can find that there are certain traits that are really important, and then we can sell that candidate to the next person, right? So you have a very less time of actually creating that impact. Next. Again, 67% of interviewers feel that not making good eye contact is the biggest mistake a candidate can make. Do you agree with this point? Of course. I mean, it is very important because, so imagine if I am doing this session and if I'm just not looking at you and I'm just looking here and there, and then I'm just saying that, yeah, 67% of people feel that this really is very important, making an eye contact. What am I really doing? Am I able to engage with my audience? Definitely no, right? I'm not able to convey what I want to my audience, right? So if you think from the same perspective, if in an interview or in a meeting, if you're not able to have an eye contact, that's the very first sign that an interviewer or an employer will come to know that you are either not comfortable with the situation or where you're being put under a limelight, where you're presenting, or you are low with confidence. So that is a very important point to know, where making an eye contact is really important. Now, another point that I would like to stress here is that while presenting, if I just start looking at yourself, looking at you continuously, and then I start talking, whatever random stuff I'm talking about, just ignore that. But if I just continuously look at you like this, and then I start talking, what will you feel? Maybe a bit intimidated, like, why is this person really looking at me like this? Okay, so let me tell you, yeah, exactly, weird, Aarti, right? So it's really weird if I continuously start looking at you, staring at you, and then I am presenting, because it is not the right way to do that, right? Okay, horrible, I got your answers. So even the way you look at a person is also very important. So if you're looking at someone for even more than 3 to 5 seconds, then guys, it is considered as a stare, right? So like, I'm literally staring at you. So you need to be very sure of how you're able to move from one audience to the other audience, how you're able to broaden your attention span, how you're able to even blink. So all of these things, it's not something that can be learned. It is a very natural thing, you know. Like, say, for example, when you even speak with your friends, you don't really need to learn that, right? You just talk in a flow. You are very casual with that person and you talk in a flow. You don't need to think that, arey, ye mera friend aaya, abhi main usko itna time dekhega, uske baad main se blink karne wala, and then again main dekhega. We are not going to do that, right? Because they are our friends and we are very comfortable in that zone, right? So this is what is important, that you need to come out of that zone irrespective of the situation that you are in, okay? Be it your friends or be it a very formal environment. You need to be very sure that you're able to connect with your audience. You're not really staring too much at a time, but at the same time, you are able to convey your message and with confidence. So basically what I'm talking here is that the crux of the matter is that confidence plays a very, very crucial role, right? Next slide. So can anyone tell me what is the lowest possible sign of confidence? We'll probably just talk from low to high. Any idea, any guesses? I'm really happy for the fact that so many people are participating. Low voice, low, being nervous. Okay. So, of course, eye contact. Great. So I have seen in my experience that even if a person is able to communicate well, like even if a person speaks well, no grammatical errors, good at English, everything works, but the time when the person is put in a spotlight, say for example, when you're asked to present something in front of the audience, or when you are giving a one-on-one interview, in that situation, it happens that all of a sudden you just go blank, right? Exactly, blackout, like you said. It is a very natural thing. It happens with all of us. When I started my career way back when I was in college, it really happens where you have done a note, you have done rehearsal of everything, but the time you are in front of that person and when you're asked to speak about it, you just go blank. But at the same time, if you're asked to write it on a piece of paper, I know that you'll be able to articulate it in a much, much better manner, right? So the main problem, the lowest possible sign of confidence level, is where you know it all, but you're just not able to express your thoughts. You're just not able to express your ideas. And like I said, this doesn't really happen to someone who is not able to speak. It even happens to someone who can speak really well, but the problem of stage fright, the problem of facing someone and talking to a person directly, that is a problem where you're not able to do it. Okay. Next. Now, a lot of time you might have also observed, I don't really need to tell you, but when we are seated, a lot of time it happens that it might even happen with you, or it might even happen with the person who's seated in front of you. You will see that the person is seated with, you know, a shrinked posture or with a hunch, like really in this particular fashion. The time you do that, the employer knows that you're not comfortable, you're not confident, because your posture says it all. So when you're seated with a hunch, shrink, that's an immediate sign of low confidence. Next. Again, while you're seated, a lot of time you'll start doing this, like twirling your hair, rubbing your nose, touching your face. You'll start fidgeting, you know, you'll start tapping, your feet start tapping. So all of these things, when you tend to do, it doesn't take much time for the employer to know that there's something wrong or you're not comfortable with that, right? So avoid these things whenever you're speaking to someone. You need to know one thing, that you should be at ease when you talk. You should be relaxed when you're talking, okay? Next. So someone did mention eye contact, and we have already spoken a lot about eye contact. Making an eye contact is definitely very important. Like I said, from my perspective, if I'm sitting here and if I'm not able to make an eye contact with you, then imagine how an interviewer feel if you're not making an eye contact with them. So you need to be very sure of making an eye contact and doing it in a right way. Like I said, you cannot be just staring at a person when you're talking. You know, you have to build that art of how to make an eye contact. Now, this is one thing where I personally feel that this can be a make or break situation as well at times. And trust me, it can be. Now, I know that the current situation is such where COVID, the coronavirus outbreak, and a lot of people will probably start doing different things, probably saying a hello from a distance or saying namaste will be a new normal, and you know, the term that we are now commonly using. But who knows? I mean, this will go on for 4 months, 5 months. We are not really sure. But you can't really take out your natural tendency of greeting someone that is doing a handshake. Maybe probably 2020 anyway has been very bad, but from next year or whenever, handshake is not something that is just going to go off, that is just going to vanish. It is not really going to happen. But the reason I'm stressing on that is because a lot of time, like I said, handshake can also be a make or break situation. And I'll also explain you why with a video which will be followed after the slide, which I'll tell you later. And I'll actually tell you this thing, that I have come across all those handshakes that are mentioned, some of the worst handshakes that are mentioned in my career. And hence I'm saying that once you probably see the video, you'll come to know. But I'll also let you know what is the proper way of doing a handshake. I'm sure a lot of you guys must already be knowing this, but I'll let you know on that front as well. Next. Again, when you're meeting someone with just a simple smile on your face, that adds a lot to your confidence level. And if you only try doing that, you know, meeting someone with a smile, greeting someone, that will create a lot of difference. And even apparently you'll see that as your interview progresses or as your meeting progresses with the people, you will automatically start seeing that sense of confidence being slowly and steadily being building within yourself. With, you know, the way you express yourself with a smile, or it could be anything. And not necessarily everyone has a tendency or everyone, for everyone, smile comes naturally. Like if you see my face, I know that I'm not someone who is very good at smiling. But if that is a problem, which is also a common thing, but if that is a problem, you need to know that you need to be expressive at least. You know, when you're not able to do that frequently, you need to be expressive so that you know that you're able to convey certain things. You're able to create an impact in what you say. So now also when I talk, I'm stressing on certain words which are really important because I want those words to feed it in your mind, right? And that is the reason expressions play a very crucial role, okay? So now when we talk of all of these things, when you're able to express ideas, when you're able to sit comfortably and talk to people, when your hand gestures, when you're fidgeting, tapping is not really happening, you're able to make an eye contact, there's a proper handshake, a simple smile, what is it, you know, at the end of the day going to lead to? A very simple thing is that all this thing will lead to effective communication. And that is where, guys, your communication level and your confidence level will be sky high, okay? So you need to make sure of all the things that are mentioned on the slide that you start practicing, making an eye contact, doing a handshake, how you should be seated, how your body posture should be. All of these things are important. And the time you start doing all this, it will actually help you in communicating very effective. Like we all know, words might be just 7%, but the rest of the thing lies on how you want to communicate those words to people, okay? So next. So this is the video that I thought of sharing with you. Now I know that it might just come across in a very funny way, but if you look at the video, there is actually a lot of things that you will probably learn, or you will need, you'll come to know that there are certain things that you need not be doing when you're doing a handshake. And once the video is done, I'll let you know how a proper handshake is done. Yeah, I hope you like the video.
If you're in business, you shake a lot of hands. So what does your handshake say about you and the people you're doing business with? Find out as we count down the top 10 bad business handshakes. Here we go with number 10, the sweaty palm. A potential deal breaker. You can't escape this nervous, sweaty grip fast enough. Yes, wipe that off. Number 9, the lobster claw. When this person shakes your hand, they pinch your hand between their thumb and fingers. It's as if they're picking up a cannibal. Definitely no good if you're allergic to shellfish. At number 8, we've got the fist bump. Nothing says I'm business savvy like a fist bump. And exploding it? Well, that's just not suitable at all, ever. Number 7, the wrestler. He flips his hand on the top of yours to assert his dominance. Rumor has it, this is the guy who put the I in team. At number 6, it's the phantom. Wow, that was quick. Let's slow it down to see what happened there. Clearly, she's got more important places to be and more important people to see. The lingerer locks in at number 5. There's shaking hands and then there's holding hands. Obviously, the lingerer has no idea which is which. Awkward. Number 4, the decliner. Decliners are fastidious folk. They won't touch a doorknob without sanitizing it, let alone shake hands. Number 3, the tickler. Everything appears normal enough, and then something feels a bit odd. It's their middle finger stroking the palm of your hand. In second place, it's the vice. Once you escape the crushing grip of the vice, you can't help but feel sorry for him. He must feel terribly inadequate. Shake hands like that. And here it is, the worst of the worst, the bottom of the barrel, the handshake only a mother could love, the dead fish. if handshakes say something about you, this one has to say you're a limp-wristed pushover who's easily battered into submission. Business.gov.au has the tools and templates to help plan, start, and grow your business so you don't get off to a shaky start.
You can pause the video. Go back to, yeah, just keep it there only. So I'm sure you saw various different handshakes, and I sincerely advise you to not ever, if you feel that there is any of those handshakes probably matches your handshake, please try and avoid. And now maybe you'll get a sense of why I'm saying that a handshake at time can be literally a make or break. Okay. Because if you're doing any of the things that I showed in the video, imagine what an interviewer or the person who will be meeting will be, you know, will have that thing, the very first impression that will be created you by the way you do the handshake. So ideally, whenever you do a handshake, you need to ensure that your grip in a handshake is firm. When I say firm, it shouldn't be like extremely firm where, you know, it becomes a painful thing for the other person, but it needs to be firm grip. Yeah. And Madhulika, like you rightly said, it should not be more than 2 to 3. I would personally even say nothing more than 2. But if the other person wants to probably do a bump more than 2 or maybe 3, just after 3, you just need to ensure that leave the hand. That is it. Because if you constantly keep on doing that and then you start communicating, oh God, it really becomes a very, very embarrassing and very awkward situation, you know, for the other person to handle. So that is why I'm saying that these things can be really a make or break. So you need to ensure that your handshake is up to the mark, is proper. Okay. So coming to the next slide. So now coming to another very important discussion, that is on your body posture when you talk. So I have just shared 4 pictures with you. Just wanted to understand what is your opinion of each and every picture. So if I talk about picture 1, do you think that is the right way of communicating or right way of standing and delivering a message? No, exactly. So I'm sure a lot of people are in agreement that when your arms are folded, it's not a right V. Okay. This basically shows that you are very uncomfortable. It's armed. It's dangerous. Never, ever, ever do this. Okay. It basically signifies that you have certain boundary that is built for yourself, and for the other person, they will feel that if we enter that boundary, you are not going to be comfortable. So this signifies a lot of negative influence. So it's known as a closed body posture. And this is something that you should always avoid when you talk. Okay. Coming to picture 2, what do you think of picture 2, whether that is the right way of conveying a message? Again, no. Completely agree. So who generally does this? What do you feel? When you're pointing, it's of course a very rude gesture. But anyway, I'm really sorry. I don't intend to kind of pinpoint anyone or anything. But even if it's a very formal or informal atmosphere, a lot of time you'll probably see that, you know, something like someone senior might just tell you that, hey, you know, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do that. Some of these things happens, right? So this kind of a posture or this thing is known as condescending, where you signify a lot about your superiority. You know, like it's my way or highway. These are the sentence which resembles this kind of a posture. So it's something that you should never be doing. Like Nidhi mentioned, dominating. So it's a dominating way, okay? It's considered to be very aggressive. It's considered to be the fact that you are superior and others are not really. at that that mark. Okay, coming to the third posture. Again, so people are saying, some are saying yes, some are saying no. Yes, a bit right, looks arrogant. Okay, so I can see there is a 50-50 thing happening here. But okay, so when I speak with you, now if you observe, whenever I'm talking, my hands are just here. So that is a good enough indication of what is the right way of communicating. But so say, for example, if I talk to you saying this, doing this kind of an action, what is it really signifying? You know, that let me handle this my way. I will do it. This is my thing. This is my, let me do this. Let me do that. And that is where you start doing this. You know, basically what it says, you're trying to suppress. So it's a very overpowering pose, which you should avoid doing that. And whenever you talk, ensure that your hand, your palms are not really facing downwards, because that is a suppressing sign and you should not be doing that. Okay. So by now, I'm very sure the fourth picture that is there is probably the way how you should be talking. So whenever you talk, you need to ensure that your palms are always pointed upwards or towards the audience, right? So when I talk, I need to ensure that my hands are either, some gestures are happening, which is either pointed toward audience or it is pointed upwards. So what this basically resembles is a person is approachable. It resembles collaboration. Like some sentences that I could relate with this is that, okay, hey, let's do this together. Let's collaborate. Let us find out some solution on this. And that is where your posture signifies something which is on collaboration. So it's basically about the attitude that you have. It reflects a very open attitude. When you have open shoulders, when you have an open posture, it signifies an open attitude as well. Okay. Yes. So I am saying that 1, 2, 3 is not a right posture. Yes. And 4 is good posture. That is what I meant, Jatin. Okay. So another thing here is that when I speak, now it's a basic thing. When I spoke about all these pictures, can we just go back to the previous slide, please? Okay, so when I spoke about all these different way of conveying messages, did it click something in your mind when I said that, okay, this way of talking is the right way of talking? Just you thought of anything, something clicked in your mind, that for how long? Okay, good enough indication I gave. Okay, I guess everyone is thinking probably. Okay, so a simple example. I cannot be talking to you continuously doing this, right? Like if I just keep on talking to you doing this, it will not, my hands, okay, my hands will pain. That is not really the thing. But so what will happen is that you cannot be continuously standing like this and talk, right? You need to have your hand movements has to happen continuously. So another way, so when you're explaining, your hand movements will be happening in this way. But when you're not explaining, what you can probably do is your palms facing each other and then you talk. Okay. So this is also known as reverse steeple, where your hands are facing each other and you talk. And when you explain, it opens up. And that is how you can keep on talking. So one habit that I have when I talk is that I always have this thing in my hand, what is known as the slide changer, right? So I'm generally comfortable keeping my hand, one hand occupied with the slide changer, and then I'll use the other hand explaining, or probably I can just use both of them and that is how I keep on explaining. But you can always think, whichever posture is something that is comfortable for you, use that. If there's nothing, you can always keep your hands in this particular way when you're talking, and when you're explaining certain things, you can always make full use of your hands. Okay. Okay. So certain things that you need to know when you are presenting. Now, this is a case where you're actually standing and presenting in front of an audience. Or take a simple example, when you are doing a presentation in your class, some assignment you've got, maximum time, what happens? Let's be very honest here. We want to impress one person in that entire classroom, right? And that will be your faculty. So at times what happens, we don't really realize that we are doing this, but we are continuously giving an attention to faculty when we are presenting. And that is something that starts happening frequently, right? So you need to ensure that when you're standing and when you're giving a presentation, you need to avoid doing that. You need to give attention to all. Avoid fidgeting with your hair. Don't twirl hair. Again, like I said, rubbing your eyes or touching your face, all of these things is something that you should be avoiding. So even if you see some TED Talks, you'll see a lot of people who are doing gestures. But if you see some senior people, like how this person is presenting in this picture, you'll see that his hands are continuously like this. And whenever he wants, he'll make very few gestures. And that is what a lot of senior people would do, if you observe. So avoid doing some of these things when you're presenting. Next. So this is one thing that I would probably suggest to you. Now, mirroring technique is something that probably a lot of trainers, client service people, sales are using. Mirroring technique is basically what, when you are trying to understand some of the behavioral traits about the other person, because their goal is just to build rapport with the other person, get the business out of them. So that is where this technique is also used. But in our session, or for our understanding, or for our improvement, what we can do is, the very simple way of doing things is just stand in front of the mirror, assess where are you lacking. It could be the way you stand, it could be your expressions, it could be your body postures. So just come to the points that are mentioned on the body posture. Yeah. So it could be your expressions. And the last part is impact through speech. So when I say impact through speech, what does that basically mean? Is that whether I'm able to give stress to some of the most important words, whether I'm able to stress on certain words, whether I'm able to give pauses wherever needed so that my message is being effectively communicated. So start practicing in front of the mirror, start as soon as possible, understand where you're good at, where you're not good at, focus on the areas of weaknesses, and that is what will help you. Now, other thing that we all know is the fact that now, you can be on the same slide, just a second. So other thing that we also need to know is that going forward, lot of times the interview might even happen through video calls as well, right? Because this used to happen before as well, but now it will be much common and much applied method. And it is something that I'm completely in agreement with, because I have come across so many times where there are some really good candidates available, but just for the fact that they are not available in the city, a lot of time it happens that people just want to ignore that and they want to meet people face to face. But going forward, I'm very sure that the mindset of people are also changing. So another thing that you can start focusing on is that you start practicing in this small box as well, because when it comes to laptop, there is very limited that you can express, right? It could be your facial expression. You can't really be showing the entire body posture, but you need to learn how to speak, how to communicate, even when it is on a laptop. So start practicing all of these things at times in front of mirror or in front of the laptop. This is something that is really going to help you. Okay. Just a sec. So now coming to another important aspect, that is business cards. So there are these four pictures that I have added here. Just wanted to have an understanding which picture you feel is the right picture of giving a business card. One. Okay. So not three for sure, not two for sure. So yeah, One is basically the right way of giving business card. Okay. Whenever you give business card, it has to be given in this particular manner. Okay. What is the right way of receiving a business card or exchanging business card? Right. So some of you are saying 4-3, but yeah, that if I'm giving a business card to someone this way, the person who will be receiving the card will also be in a similar way. So we need to ensure that we are giving the business card this way and we are taking the business card this way as well. Right. Now, this is just one way. So if you can just click ahead. Yeah. So this will basically show you which is the right way and which is not the right way. But even here, you need to know some of the things when you're actually giving the business card. Now, a lot of time I've observed this thing that people will share their business card, but they don't really know what should be facing my side and what should be facing their side. So just for your reference, when you give a business card, you need to ensure that the information that is mentioned on your business card should be facing the visitor, the person who you're meeting, so that I get to read. Okay. That is the way you should be exchanging your business card. Okay. Second important thing is that when you receive a business card from someone, always, always ensure that you don't just take the card and immediately put it in your pocket or put it in your wallet. That is a very wrong way of dealing with the business card. The time you receive the business card, you need to ensure that you keep it on the table where your meeting is set. Until the meeting is happening, the card is on the table. You're not really doing anything with that card or just not playing around with that card. Trust me, you should never do that because it is a sign of disrespect. Okay. So treating the card in a particular way is really important. Now, third thing here is, although there is no specific rule in this, but I would say that whenever you're giving a card, it's always better that you have a nice business card case, okay, from which you're giving the card, because that always adds to certain professionalism. Now, I'm very sure if you go to some basic stores or a caterer or anything, they'll just handle the card and they'll just tell you, ki, haan, ye number pe call karo or whatever aapka delivery hai, wo dekh lijiye. You know, that is how it is. But if you're in a formal environment, you always ensure that you are carrying a nice business case. It always adds value. Okay. So always ensure that you have a nice business card case and you take your card out from that and then you deliver the business card. Okay. This is another very, very important point that I thought of sharing it with you guys. Because networking is also super important from a point of view that it also reflects some kind of your confidence level as well, depending on how you network. Now, networking on a social media thing, I'm not even talking about that. You start adding friends randomly on Insta or on Facebook. That is not something that I am talking about here. That is actually your acquaintances. You do whatever you feel there, that is fine. But on LinkedIn, I can tell you from my experience that I generally keep on getting random connection requests. It could be for a lot of reasons, maybe for hiring purpose or looking for jobs or to get some kind of an information. It could be anything. But it's just a basic courtesy that when you send a network, it's always advisable that, you know, just drop a message to that person saying, hi, thanks for accepting request, or I would like to seek certain advice. It will be great if I can get some time from you and get to know certain things. Start interacting. Because what will happen is that if you are just adding people on LinkedIn, you might just show your friends that, hey, look, I have 5,000, 10,000, 15,000 networks on LinkedIn. But tomorrow, if an unfortunate situation comes, like maybe the current economic situation, which is not really that great, or anything happens, and if you put up any information that you're looking for some information, you're looking for a job or anything, not many people are probably going to end up looking at your post or helping. There could be few, but the chances are very less. So the more you build a healthy connection is important. Now, how you can build a healthy connection? A, like I said, is you can definitely drop a message, keep in touch with them, ask certain questions on message. What would be more better than this is probably if you can just able to buy some time from that network. And that is, my friend, where the healthy networking comes in picture. So if you're able to buy some time, just ask him if I can just probably get 10-15 minutes to speak with you. I have certain queries. And trust me, all, if not all, but a lot of people just love sharing their experiences. A lot of people love sharing advices, giving advices. So it is always preferable that you just pick up a chat with them on call, decide on a particular time, have your queries, have your questions sorted. What is it that you want to ask that person and get an information on? That is something that will be really great in terms of networking. And that is something that will help you in actually building your network. What is much better than this, other than talking to people, will be if you're able to actually meet that person in, you know, in a meeting, having a meeting one-on-one. Now, there are certain tips and tricks here as well. And these are some of the secrets that I'm telling you guys. It's not only for the purpose of just building your confidence. Yes, that is crucial. But these are some other methods as well of probably looking out for a job other than just continuously applying on Naukri.com, iimjobs, LinkedIn. This is also another way you can start building a very good rapport with some of the people. Right. So one way what you can do is always tell them that, you know, we have some survey going on in our college and we need to buy some time, maybe just a 15-20 minute of your time will be great. I'm sure not everyone would be able to give that time to you, but out of 50, I can say at least 5 people will say yes to you. You'll get to meet them. What happens there is, imagine a person with like 20-25 years of experience is literally pouring his experience in the span of 15 minutes for you. Like, imagine how enriching, how important that information could be, rather than just sending a request and you're done. Try doing these, because that is something that will keep on giving you lot of information. So if you're able to buy some time, get to meet that person in his or her office, whichever way, that is something that will really help you. And these are some of the ways that you can always seek an appointment from them. Okay. If you can click next. Okay. So how many of you are even aware that on LinkedIn, there is something called as a career advice option? Is anyone aware of this? Okay, not many people are responding. No. Okay. So guys, just start using LinkedIn. Start exploring LinkedIn is what I'm saying. I'm not here to promote LinkedIn or do anything of that sort, but I'm telling you that it is a very useful tool for networking. And this is something that is going to help you from a long-term perspective. Okay. So if you go on LinkedIn, there is an option where you can start putting your queries on certain questions about your career. Say, for example, someone is into field of IT programming. A person has a query on how to improve my skills in Java and this and that. There are actually people who have that expertise and who are considered as career advisors on LinkedIn. So whatever you type, it apparently goes to them, and you can actually approach them as well, or they can also drop you a message and say that, okay, I am here to help you out. How do you want me to help you? So try exploring all these options. This is something that will be really important for you. Okay. Third are influencers. Is anyone aware of Bridget Hyacinth or Kirsty Bonner or Oleg Vishnopolsky? Now, these are some of the people who are very known, very renowned. Like, if you follow some of these people on LinkedIn, you'll be getting daily some kind of career advice, some kind of information about how to go about applying for a job, how to work on your personality, how to speak effectively, how you should be answering to some of the questions. Do start following some of these influencers, because it will help you big time is all I can say. Okay, there could be a lot of people that you can follow. If anyone has heard about Simon Sinek, now he has immense information about how the millennials work, the future workforce, how the relation should be between a leader and the employers. So there's a lot to learn from some of these key influencers. So start following certain influencers. You'll start getting a lot of information. Okay. Fourth is, again, now a lot of us know that webinar is something that is happening. It is going to become, again, a very normal thing going forward. Webinar used to happen before as well, but now a lot of people are focusing on registering for webinar. There are live videos happening on Insta, live sessions happening on LinkedIn. So whenever you're registering there as well, you will apparently find a lot of people from different fields. You basically get a chance to network with other people as well. Okay, so you can send them a request, understand what they are doing, if there's any kind of career guidance that you can get from them. So also these things will also help you. Okay. Last part is following up, not really following, but follow certain people. Now, this is also another secret where not many people are kind of aware of. I can tell you this. There are a lot of recruiters available on Naukri, available on iimjobs, available on LinkedIn. The best thing to do is whenever you are searching for a job, for example, on Naukri.com, you will see the name of the recruiter there. Sometimes there's a name of recruiter, sometimes there's just a company mentioned, whatever. But whenever you're doing this, check the name of the recruiter. You have an option of following that recruiter directly on Naukri as well. The other best thing that you can do is that you can just go on LinkedIn, copy paste the name, check the recruiter, follow the recruiter, send a request. Do the same for iimjobs. Check the person, you're getting the name, check on LinkedIn, follow that person. What better than that is when you're applying on LinkedIn, you'll always get an option whether you can follow that company or not. Start following these companies, because then you'll see that every day your LinkedIn account will be flooded with information, like literally flooded with a lot of information. Imagine there are a lot of influencers that you're following. There are a lot of companies that you're following. There are a lot of recruiters who are continuously posting daily basis. You will be flooded with a lot of information, and you don't really need to even look out on how I can work on this, how I can do that. Just by picking up a chat, just by meeting someone, just by checking a lot of things on LinkedIn, just by building your network in a healthy, in a fruitful manner. When I say healthy networking, these are the ways of building your network. And the reason I'm saying even this needs a lot of confidence is because at times it happens to a lot of people. It happened to me as well at the start of my career, where, you know, approaching someone who's complete stranger and who's like really a very senior person, it becomes a little difficult for us. But we need to start building that confidence that, okay, I don't mind. I can actually go ahead. I can send him a request. I can just drop him a formal hi, hello. I can just ask him for some time. If it is possible, great. If it is not possible, no harm. I can keep on doing that and start building my network in a way where people know me. People at least know me in their network. Like even other thing that I told you about seeking career advice, or even probably just meeting a person face to face in their office. Now imagine from the employer perspective, when that person knows that you've come all the way to meet him, imagine the kind of impact that you're creating. That person knows that you're not just here for information, or probably not, you're not just here for a job. You're really interested to work with them. You're really interested to know that company, work for that company. And even when he or she understands your interest level, tomorrow, if the position is open in their company, they might even feel that, let's just call this candidate who had met me last time. I see a lot of potential. He or she may not have experience, but I see that desire. I see that passion. And, you know, wonders can happen. So start networking. Don't shy away from networking, because this is something that will help you from a long-term perspective. Okay. So just to conclude on my presentation, I had another small video. It's kind of a recap on how, like I told you, different mediums of communication, you speak, your tone of voice, your gestures, your body language, all are important. But I'm sure all of us have watched Friends, right? Friends series. But has anyone really thought of learning some of the key traits from that series? If you've gone through that video, it's really great. But if you've not gone through it, I'm very sure that you'll probably come to know some really important tips and tricks where you can express or you can convey your information through your expressions, your body language, your gestures. So just go through the video and I hope you like the video. Let's see. Was it there? Great. So if you probably saw that there were a lot of different ways of communicating and still able to express or convey what they wanted to say. So when you are aware of how you can use different forms of communication, and that is when you will be able to express your ideas. That is, my friend, is the art of communication. So with that, I would like to conclude the session today. I hope I have not taken a lot of time. But yeah, if you wish to have a chat, or if you want to know anything else, you want to have any questions, you can always connect with me on LinkedIn. I'm always there to answer any of your queries, if any time, whenever. So I would hand over it to Sneha, ma'am, or how's
it? Thank you, sir, for the lovely session. And you've covered all the points, you know, from the handshakes to exchanging the business cards, and also, you know, the classic examples from friends. I mean, I think that is something where each and every student will be having those images engraved in their mind.
Yeah. I see that.
Right. I will just quickly move into the question and answer round, where we have a lot of questions coming in from the students. So some of them, you know, have been working with some companies as interns. Some of them will be starting their corporate journey. So any tips on emailing? Because, you know, generally when in a student life, they're not very used to sending out formal emails to their friends or for, you know, any sort of a communication. It's only when it comes to applying for jobs, they make those formal emails. But once you are in the job as an intern or as an employee, any tips are on having those emails?
So definitely a very interesting question. Probably this is also one thing that I generally take care of in some of my sessions. Whenever you're drafting a mail, you should always be sure of, again, conveying a message is very important, but then in your subject line, what you are writing, or in the main body, what you're writing is something that is really important. So if you're writing a mail for an opening for, say, client service or a marketing profile, always mention that application for marketing role with a company, or if it's a consultant, you can always mention which company or what client is it. If you have a reference, whether you got to know about some information via LinkedIn or via Naukri.
Right.
I'm so sorry. So if you have that reference, always mention that reference. Now in the main subject body, you will probably need to ensure that salutation is definitely needed. But again, it depends from industry to industry. Now, like if you apply in something like a hospitality, you will see that there is a sir, madam culture. So you need to respect that. You'll probably need to write accordingly. If you're dropping a mail in a media company, where I have been like for almost 10 years of my life, I know that sir, madam culture doesn't really exist. It's a very different way. But you can always say a hi, dear XYZ, hi XYZ. Start your information by writing what is the mail regarding to. That is how your first introduction should be. What is the mail regarding about an opening, through whatever references that you got. The second para is where you need to write at least 4 points. Now, this is something that I'm saying from an HR perspective. So when we do internal parity check with number of candidates that we have, we look at 4 things at least. Yeah. One is the company where you are currently working with. The other is the number of years of experience that you have. The third is the CTC. A lot of time people wish not to disclose, which is also fine. If you can disclose, that is also okay. And whether, of course, your number of years of experience. Now, that is industry related or that is non-industry related. So some of these things is something that it's better that you always write, because it is very easy then for a recruiter to just go through your mail, know what all you have done, and then just, you know, make his notes accordingly.
Right.
And of course, you can also put some information on what your core competencies are. That also adds value, because now if the role, say from an HR perspective, I'm an HR, so I can probably give that example. But if there's a role for an HR business partner, I would rather want to highlight what is it that I am doing as a business partner. Have I been involved in Mancom meetings? Have I been involved in strategy related work? So I'll probably write something which are really my core competencies. Like it could be budgeting, it could be employer branding, it could be something key contribution in performance management. Once you share this information, then you can always conclude saying that look forward to hearing you, hear from you. Kindly let us know the way forward and end the mail. I have certain sample mails. I don't know. I mean, if it is needed, I can show.
Yes, that will be good for our students. Yeah.
Okay. Do I have access for screen sharing?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So here, is it visible?
Yes. Yeah. You'll have to click on the image. Yeah.
So these are some of the live samples that I have actually got a mail. Okay. In some of my previous company. Now, if you see this mail,
the image is still loading.
Oh, it is still loading. Okay. It has opened. Okay. Is it open?
No, not visible.
Okay. Not sure. So I think there's anyway some problem, but anyway, let me not just waste a lot of time. But what I was saying is that there are a lot of times case where people just send a CV and they forget to type or give any information about themselves. You just drop a CV, no salutation, nothing. And imagine from a recruiter's perspective, if I know that you are not even bothered to spend some time in explaining your candidature, then for a recruiter, why are you even expecting the recruiter to even put that kind of an impetus on your CV, your candidate?
Correct.
Always very important on that.
Sir, Ankita Mishra, Aarti Mishra has a question that, you know, we being freshers, a lot of students are freshers here in today's session. So what all should they mention on their emails and when they are applying for jobs?
Very, very interesting question. In fact, this is something that I do occasionally when I am giving session in NAMD as well. It becomes really difficult when you're competing with someone who has experience and when you are a fresher. But that is the time you need to think through, deep dive, whatever you have done in the past, be it in college, be it in personal life, be it some voluntary work, you need to start thinking about yourself. The very first thing that I can come across is your internship experience, wherever you're studying, some kind of internship that you have done. Focus on those things, okay? Talk about your internship experience, where you have done. Now, when I say internship, now it is particularly hard for someone who's a fresher. So when you say you've done an internship, don't really end up saying that I did internship with XYZ company, that is it. Highlight a lot more things, like if you work for a particular company, what was your role in that? What have you contributed? What was your achievement? If there is something that you can talk in terms of the kind of budgets that you dealt with, the scale of the work that you handled, start highlighting more on that front. Second important thing that I would suggest is, not many people do this, but I get thoroughly, thoroughly impressed when people come up with a showcase of their portfolio. Like, you have done internship, you've done a lot of things. Like I said, I keep on doing some volunteering work. I love doing that. Everything really counts, everything matters. So whatever you've done, try and build a good portfolio of that, you know, via PPT or via whichever way, and share that kind of a work with the employer as well. Share the portfolio, like whatever you've done. If you get a chance to speak with them, there's no harm, you know, in between just giving an introduction about yourself and probably just asking them, you know, whenever you get a chance, just ask them, okay, would you like to see some of the work that I've done? No one is obviously going to say no to you, but that is also going to create an interest in front of the employer that, okay, this guy is so in his efforts to get this job. And when you start presenting your portfolio, that this is what I've done, start using certain pictures wherever you work as an intern. Take pictures of some of the key things that you're doing there, or highlight certain important things. Highlight some of the people who you've worked with. I'm sorry. So even that can help, because the industry is always small. Who knows, maybe that recruiter might be even knowing the person who you've worked with, and that can again build a very strong connection. It can all happen. So use of some of these people that you've worked with.
Right.
Start putting some pictures, your contribution, make your portfolio a really worthy portfolio where people would want to see that, and then that interest is generated.
That would definitely have an advantage and edge over others, where the candidate may be perceived as a more tech savvy candidate also, and their presentation skills are also seen during that interview as well.
Of course, exactly, to the point, like you said, even the presentation skills are viewed. That person knows that arre kal mujhe like PPT banana hoga, this guy is already there, he knows. Yeah. If I want to do some Excel data, that guy already knows, so he's good at that work.
Correct.
So that way also it helps, and you won't see someone who is coming with experience doing putting so much of effort. I'm definitely not comparing anyone, some people might even do that, but the chances could be less because that person already knows, he can speak with his experience. You don't have anything, you can probably talk with your portfolio.
Yes. And as everybody says that the visuals always work much better than speaking about it.
So absolutely.
Definitely and nowadays a lot of apps and the softwares are available to quickly make a presentation either on a PPT or even on your phone. They can quickly make, add some pictures, write about whatever they've done. So definitely that will be
even, there are certain apps that I would like to share. If anyone is aware, great, but I'm sure most of you might be. There's something called as Canva, there's something called as Infographics, and all of these things are very different way where your presentation, the beauty of that presentation is altogether at a different level compared to what you do it on a PPT. So
yeah,
you can try some of these different softwares as well.
Great. Sir, we also have the next question from Madhulika Singh. It's a classic question that students are always asked about their strengths and weaknesses. How do you answer it in the right way?
Okay, strengths and weaknesses. Yeah, at times that this is the kind of question that is being put forth. I genuinely appreciate when a person gives me an honest reply on this. When someone says that, okay, my weakness is something like completely a rubbish answer that, you know what, I'm trying to improve on. Like, I've literally come across an answer where people will say, I'm trying to improve on my handwriting, and I'm trying to do certain things like improving my temper. But the more honest that you are, the better it is. So if you're talking about strengths, yeah, a lot of people will come to know. Everyone will say that through my experience, I've done this. I was a team player. I have good analytical skills. You need to deep dive into yourself. You need to self-introspect you as a person. What have you done throughout your internship or throughout your experience, whether you were good at analytics? And also, the best thing is if you can prove it with some kind of an experience. So if I'm saying today that I'm analytically very strong, I can work on data of 10,000 just on a fingertip on Excel because I am super fast on Excel. I know various formulas. You need to have some example to even prove that, because no one just wants to hear something that is just off the top and there is no really concrete evidence.
Right.
Now, problem is when you come to the weakness part, because a lot of time it happens that you can talk a lot about your strengths, but when it comes to your weakness, people just end up thinking, okay, what could be my weakness? And then people will say, I don't have patience, or at times I made some mistake, I goofed up, but then I managed. Try on talking about weakness that are genuine, like could be a patience or could be anything specific that you feel that is actually there, but also talk about what are you currently doing to overcome the weakness.
Right.
That is something that will definitely help you.
Correct.
When you're supporting your strengths and when you're supporting weaknesses.
Right. So we have the next question from Vedika Tolani. She has a question that what if, during the interview, a question comes up from the employer side for which the candidate is not so prepared and may not be able to answer it well. So how can you answer it well and at the same time not lose that confidence level?
Again, be yourself when you are being interviewed. The very first thing that you need to not think of is, are mere confidence ka kya hoga? Okay. Of course, there will be a lot of questions which will be tricky, which some you might have an answer, you might not have an answer. the important thing there is that you are relaxed, you are at ease, and the interviewer is able to gauge that the person is confident. See, understand from an interviewer's perspective as well, he or she already know that there are certain things that you will obviously not be knowing. With someone who's a fresher, having an in-depth knowledge about a particular thing is definitely not possible. So if such kind of a question comes where you're not able to answer that question or you don't know anything about it, you can always tell them that I'm not aware about it. I have not really done it in my work-wise, but there are certain things that are revolving around it. Say, for example, if you're not good at Excel work, but you have done something around it, like you can always talk about that, like that there was some data that I had managed, plenty of data. There was my colleague who helped me in this and I have accordingly gained knowledge. But yes, with experience, I can definitely work on this if given an opportunity. Right. But never ever you have to start thinking that if I'm not able to give that answer, then how do I ensure that my confidence level is still high?
Correct.
Don't think about confidence at all when you're answering. The time you start thinking mera confidence, you will be in a problem.
Right. Sir, as we are just falling short of time, almost exceeded, I'll just take the last question. At times there are gaps in studies or there are gaps in employment. How can you cover that up during the interview? How can you sound positive and during that interview, how would you handle that? How would you put that point forward?
So if there's a gap in study, I don't think people would be stressing a lot on that because there could be a lot of personal reasons. Of course, when you have a gap in study, there could be a lot of personal reasons. The best way of tackling a situation where there's an employment gap is the lesser you speak about it, the better it is. So say, for example, you had something with your previous employment, things didn't work out, you had maybe some family issues, which is very personal to you, but because of that reason, you had an employment gap, you don't really need to talk about that entire issue. Just mention that there was a personal reason in my family because of which I couldn't continue. It was an unfortunate event and hence there was a gap. If you feel that there was some health issues that had happened, you don't really need to elaborate on that. Ki, aray, mera accident hua tha, I met with this thing, that happened. The more you start talking about that particular thing, no, then it is a case where people will start feeling that there could be some problem. The lesser you speak about it, the less of a stress you give on that part, the better it is. And nowadays, you will see a lot of people have gaps in their careers. It is not really a big deal. Now, imagine the current thing that is happening with coronavirus, and I'm sure people know that the lot of people have lost jobs. It's almost up to 30-40% of the working population have lost their jobs.
Right.
So I don't think so. It is going to create a lot of problems. If there's a genuine reason, just be genuine and just be open. The more you talk about your gap with confidence and with less of explanation, that is going to help you.
Correct. Thank you, Abhijit sir, for your time, and thank you for the wonderful insights for today's session. There have been a lot of questions from the students, but we have not been able to take all of that. But I'm sure a lot of areas have been discussed in today's session for professional etiquettes. And with that, we come to the end of our session, our series for personal grooming and image building series. We have had a couple of sessions on power personality, fitness mantra, social etiquettes, dressing etiquettes. We would genuinely like to thank Mr. Shakir Sheikh, Vijay Vikram Singh sir, Mr. Mahesh Malik, Sucheta Sharma James, Nishank Senani, and of course for today's session, Abhijit Patil sir. With all these sessions and at the completion of these series, I hope the participants have taken back a lot and they found this useful. Mannerisms and behavior, the way one dresses up, the way you have to remain fit, the way you carry yourself, your first impressions, all of this we have discussed a lot in all of these sessions, and we had a fantastic time arranging these sessions. I hope you all found that useful too. I would definitely like to thank the BK Birla Autonomous College and the entire management, respected director, Dr. Naresh Chandra sir, respected principal, Dr. Avinash Patil sir, and Dr. Harish Dubey sir. I would request Harish Dubey sir to please speak a few words on this session, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much, Neha ma'am. And first of all, I would like to compliment Mr. Abhijit Patil for the wonderful presentation what he gave today. I have attended so many sessions, even in this session also, but I can tell you it was one of the best session I have ever attended.
Thank you, sir.
Compliments to you, sir. And I hope and I'm sure your more sessions will come up and they are going to benefit the students at a large scale.
I would be more than happy to help.
I would also like to mention here that as Sneha madam mentioned that we had a lot of sessions and regarding social etiquette, personal etiquettes, then personal grooming and so many sessions in the series of this personal etiquettes and grooming. And when we have any marathon, it is important to have a good start. But at the same time, it is also important to have a sprint finish. So I think the talk of Mr. Abhijit Patil has been a very good finish to our marathon of this series of personal grooming. And the way he has presented and the topics, what he has covered, starting from body language, communication skills, then your social etiquettes. So many things I have noted down, so many things. In fact, I was also making a note of this. And it was wonderful and very beneficial for the present generation. And there were beautiful questions based on how to go for the interview, what are the techniques for the interview. And I think Mr. Abhijit has covered everything so nicely. And although it was just a professional etiquette, but he has covered various aspects of the personal etiquettes and the other grooming as well. So on behalf of BK Birla College and my personal behalf, on behalf of our director, principal, all our staff members and students, I thank you, sir, very much for accepting our invitation and gracing the wonderful talk to the students in the benefit of their development. So once again, I would like to thank, and I would also like to thank our team, Nest Academy, of which I also consider to be part of. I don't consider they are me in this. I always consider that I'm also integrated part of them. So I'm also thankful to Nest Academy, in particular, Mr. Balkishan Sharma ji, Mr. Vipul Solanki, Ms. Sneha Asar, and everybody who has been instrumental in organizing this kind of event. And I'm sure the series of personal grooming must have benefited thousands of students from the country at large for their personal development, for their professional developments and so on. So once again, I thank everyone. And also I would like to mention, and I would like to thank our management, in particular our chairman, Shri War Chitlange ji, and Mr. B.P. Karwa ji, for providing all kind of digital platform in the propagating this kind of event at larger extent through Facebook, YouTube, and so many other channels. And thanks everyone. Thanks to the all participants who have attended today. And because of the participants only, this kind of events are possible. I can see the resource person gets motivated when they see the number getting increased. So I think they are the real motivators to the resource person, because they are giving their heart and soul. And if there are nobody to listen to them, it also demotivates them. So I think the thanks are also due to the all participants and those who have listened to us. Once again, thank you very much, sir, for accepting our invitation. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Just one last announcement, that the certificates will be issued to all the participants who've attended the entire series. We will be letting you know very soon when you all will be receiving the certificates. In a few days' time, we'll get back to you on that. And definitely all the ones who've attended all the sessions will be getting the certificates. And thank you once again. Thank you all for attending this session and making this series a huge success. Thank you. You can let us know your feedback on the social media handles of BK Birla College Kalyan. You can also let us know your feedback on the Facebook, on the comment section, or you can tag us on your stories and on your posts. Thank you so much. Stay home, stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you.